My other soul is trying to manipulate the tumor microenvironment, not only indolent B-cell lymphoma, but also in patients with aggressive B-cell lymphoma who receive CAR T-cell therapy, and trying to understand better about the tumor microenvironment and how this can affect CAR T-cell therapy efficacy. So, as everybody knows, the level of homeostatic and cytokines such as interleukin-15 right before CAR T infusion is very important because CAR T cells are dependent on these cytokines. And this is one of the many reasons why we do give lympho-depleting chemo before CAR T cell infusion so that we can decrease endogenous lymphocytes that would otherwise consume these homeostatic cytokines. And we can keep those levels high right before CAR T cell infusion. But we don't know yet whether the change in homeostatic cytokines before lymphodepleting chemo and after lymphodepleting chemo is as relevant as just the absolute number right before CAR T cell infusion. And one surrogate marker for this delta, this change, is the delta in lymphocyte count before and after lymphodepleting chemo in patients with relapsed refractory large B-cell lymphoma or received CAR T. So to address this question, we performed a retrospective study at MD Anderson that included patients with relapsed or refractory large B-cell lymphoma who received standard of care axi-cel between 2018 and 2020. And all patients received standard lymphodepleting chemo with fludarabine and cyclophosphamide. And response was assessed prospectively with Lugano 2014 and then with a PET-CT scan. Overall, 171 patients with large B-cell lymphoma were included in this study. This was a typical non-clinical trial population with a median age of 59 years and 56% of patients having a poor international prognostic index. Also, this was a heavily pretreated population that had been previously exposed to multiple lines of therapy, autologous transplant, and allogeneic transplant. So what we did, we looked into the difference between absolute lymphocyte count before initiation of lymphodepleting chemo and at day zero, so right before CAR T cell infusion. And we call this number DLIX. And we tried to see whether there was any factor associating with a higher or lower DLIX and whether DLIX itself associated with a better or worse outcome. What we saw is that looking into multiple pre-treatment characteristics all collected before day minus five, the only factor that a multivariate analysis associated with a smaller DLIX and so with a less important change in levels of lymphocyte count before and after lymphodepleting chemo was bridging therapy. This is very important because we all know that it's very important to try to bridge patients to CAR T cell therapy with the least possible amount of disease because patients with high tumor burden tend to have a lower chance of staying in remission and also can have a higher toxicity. However, the way we try to do it with bridging therapy matters. Doing chemoimmunotherapy as compared to immunotherapy or biological therapy or radiation therapy may matter because this is going to affect not only the entity, the extent of tumor burden, but also the tumor microenvironment overall. So in this case, we saw that bridging therapy in general, though we were unable to dissect based on the type of bridging therapy, was associated with a lower DLIX and then with consequently also with lower levels of homeostatic cytokines right before CAR T cell infusion. As the next step, we looked into DLIX and association with outcome, separating DLIX in quartiles. And what we saw is that patients with a high DLIX, defined as a quartile two or higher, tended to have a meaningfully longer progression-free and overall survival. Now, it's very hard, even in CAR T populations, to identify prognostic factors, so factors associated with longer overall survival beyond LDH and tumor burden. But DLIX did. As a matter of fact, a patient with very high DLIX had a median PFS of 9 months as opposed to 3 months, and median overall survival was not reached as opposed to 7 months. Of course, this is only a retrospective, very descriptive, and single-center study, and we need to gather more biological information. What's really the corresponding side from a biological perspective of this DLIX? Is there any specific cytokine or chemokine that matters? Do polymorphisms in enzymes responsible for lymphodepleting chemo metabolism matter? So all these questions are currently being addressed on peripheral blood samples collected in our patients. measurements at day minus five and day zero. And hopefully this will provide biological information in the future and actionable targets that we may use to improve the overall efficacy of CAR T cell therapy for patients with aggressive B-cell lymphoma.